Hi, so let's start with Chapter 8, Principles of Laparoscopic and Robotic Surgery. Definition: minimal access surgery is a product of modern technology and surgical innovation that aims to accomplish surgical therapeutic goals with minimal somatic and psychological trauma. This type of surgery has reduced wound access trauma as well as being less disfiguring than conventional techniques. It can offer cost effectiveness to both health services and employers by shortening operating times, shortening hospital stays, improving operative precision compared to open surgery in some, but not all, cases and allowing faster recuperation. Extent of minimal access surgery. The first introduction of an experimental laparoscopic procedure was by George Kelling of Dresden in 1901. He termed it celioscopy and used Nitz's cystoscope. This was followed by Hans Christian Jacobi's successful application in Umeå in Sweden. Despite the work of these pioneers, it took another 70 years before Patrick Steptoe applied this approach to patients in United Kingdom in 1980 and Philip Moret's first video laparoscopic cholecystectomy was performed in Lyon, France in 1987. However, since its mainstream adoption in the mid-1990s, minimal access surgery has crossed all traditional boundaries of specialties and disciplines. Shared, borrowed, and overlapping technologies and information are encouraging a multidisciplinary approach that serves the whole patient rather than a specific organ system. The core principles of minimal access surgery, independent of procedure or device, can be summarized by the acronym IVITROS, IVITROS. I, insufflate or create space to allow surgery to take place in the minimal access setting. We visualize the tissue's anatomical landmarks and the environment for the surgery to take place. I, identify the specific structures for surgery. T, triangulate surgical tools such as port placement to optimize the efficiency of their action and ergonomics by minimizing overlap and clashing of instruments. R, retract and manipulate local tissues to improve access and gain entry into the correct tissue planes. O, operate incise suture anastomose fuse. S, seal or hemostasis. Broadly speaking, minimal access techniques can be categorized as follows. Laparoscopy. A rigid endoscope. Laparoscope is introduced through a port into the peritoneal cavity. This is insufflated with carbon dioxide to produce a pneumoperitoneum. Further, ports are inserted to enable instrument access and they are used for dissection. It is generally accepted that laparoscopic cholecystectomy has revolutionized the surgical management of cholelithiasis and has become the mainstay of management of uncomplicated gallstone disease. With improved instrumentation, advanced procedures such as laparoscopic cholecystectomies for malignancies previously regarded as controversial have also become fully accepted. There continues to be substantive evidence demonstrating the short-term benefits of laparoscopic surgery over open surgery with regard to post-operative pain, length of stay, and earlier return to normal activities. However, the equivalence of the benefits in term outcomes as such as oncological quality and cancer-related survival has not been established. So we will see the figures 8.1. Common laparoscopic trocars are shown. In figure 8.1b, common laparoscopic instruments are shown. I'll zoom it so that you can see properly. Thoracoscopy, a rigid endoscope is introduced through an incision in the chest to gain access to the thoracic contents. Usually there is no requirement for gas insufflation as the operating space is held open by the rigidity of the thoracic cavity. In specific cases such as mediastinal tumor resection and diaphragmatic surgery, gas insufflation at low pressure 5 to 8 mmHg may be applied. Endoluminal endoscopy. Flexible or rigid endoscopes are introduced into hollow organs or systems such as the urinary tract, upper or lower gastrointestinal tract, and respiratory and vascular systems. Perivisceral endoscopy. Body planes can be assessed even in the absence of natural cavity. Examples are mediastinoscopy, retroperitoneoscopy and retroperitoneal approach to the kidney, aorta and lumbar sympathetic chain. Extraperitoneal approaches to the retroperitoneal organs as well as hernia repair are now becoming increasingly commonplace, further decreasing morbidity associated with visceral peritoneal manipulation. Other more recent examples include subfacial ligation of incompetent perforating veins in varicose vein surgery. Arthroscopy and intra-articular joint surgery. Orthopedic surgeons have applied arthroscopy access to the knee for some time and are applying this modality to other joints including the shoulder, wrist, elbow and hip. Combined approach, the diseased organ is visualized and treated by an assortment of endoluminal and extraluminal endoscopes and other imaging devices. Examples include the combined laparoendoscopic procedure for the management of biliary lithiasis, colonic polyp excision and several urological procedures such as pyeloplasty and donor nephrectomy. In some cases, the application of this procedure, this combined approach offers the ability to execute operations via a single incision, thereby better adhering to the minimal invasive approach. The evidence for improved outcomes using these combined approaches remain limited for the majority of procedures. Surgical trauma in open, minimally invasive and robotic surgery. Most of the trauma of an open procedure is inflicted because the surgeon must have a wound that is large enough to give adequate exposure for safe dissection at a target site. The wound is often the cause of morbidity, including infection, dehiscence, bleeding, herniation, and nerve entrapment. Wound pain prolongs recovery time and by reducing mobility contributes to an increased incidence of pulmonary atelectasis, chest infection, paralytic ileus, and deep venous thrombosis. Mechanical and human retractors cause additional trauma. Body wall retractors can inflict localized damage that may be as painful as the wound itself. In contrast, during laparoscopy, the retraction is provided by the low-pressure pneumoperitoneum, giving a diffuse force applied gently and evenly over the whole body wall, causing minimal trauma. Exposure of any body cavity to the atmosphere also causes morbidity through cooling and fluid loss by evaporation. There is also evidence that the incidence of post-surgical adhesions has been reduced by the use of minimal invasive laparoscopic, thoracoscopic and robotic procedures, which has been suggested to result from less damage to delicate serosal coverings. In the manual handling of intestinal loops, the surgeon and assistant disturb the peristaltic activity of the gut and provoke adynamic ileus. Minimal access surgery has many advantages, such as a reduction in the trauma of access and exposure and an improvement in visualization. While minimal access methods have been an established modality in some elective surgical procedures, they are now also being increasingly applied with success in emergency surgical procedures, including perforated viscous repair, such as omental patch repair of the stomach and washout of localized perforation of diverticular disease. Advantages of minimal access surgery, summary 8.1. Decrease in wound size, reduction in wound infection, dehiscence, bleeding, herniation and nerve entrapment. Decrease in wound pain, improved mobility, decreased wound trauma, decreased heat loss, improved visualization. Limitations of minimal access surgery. Despite its many advantages, minimal access surgery has its limitations. To perform minimal access surgery with safety, the surgeon must operate remote from the surgical using an imaging system that provides a two-dimensional representation of the operative site. The endoscope offers a whole new anatomical landscape which the surgeon must learn to navigate without the usual open approach clues that make it easy to judge depth. The instruments are longer and sometimes more complex to use than those commonly used in open surgery. This results in the novice being faced with significant problems of hand-eye coordination. Here there is a well-described learning curve for novice surgeons and experienced open surgeons when adopting to minimal invasive approach. Some of the procedures performed by these new approaches are more technically demanding and are slower to perform, and they often have a more difficult learning curve as tactile feedback to the surgeon is lost. Indeed, on occasion, a minimal invasive operation is so technically demanding that both patient and surgeon are better served by conversion to an open procedure. Unfortunately, there seems to be a sense of shame associated with conversion, which is quite unjustified. It is vital for surgeons and patients to appreciate that the decision to close or to convert it to an open operation is not a complication, but instead usually implies sound surgical judgment in favor of patient safety. Another problem occurs when there is intraoperative arterial bleeding. Hemostasis may be very difficult to achieve endoscopically because blood obscures the field of vision and there is significant reduction of the image quality due to light absorption.
Another disadvantage of laparoscopic surgery is the loss of tactile feedback in the context of some procedures. Although many procedures have been successfully performed without traditional sense of tactile feedback, this is an area of ongoing research in haptics and biofeedback system. Early work suggested that laparoscopic ultrasonography might be a substitute for the need to feel in intraoperative decision making. The rapid progress in advanced laparoscopic techniques, including biliary tract exploration and surgery for malignancies, has provided a strong impetus for the development of laparoscopic ultrasound. Now, more developed, this technique already has advantages that far outweigh its disadvantages. In more advanced techniques, large pieces of resected tissue, such as the lung or colon, may have to be extracted from the body cavity. Occasionally, the extirpated tissue may be removed through a nearby natural orifice, such as the rectum or the mouth. At times, a novel route may be employed. For instance, a benign colonic specimen may be extracted through an incision in the vault of the vagina. Several innovative tube systems have been shown to facilitate this extraction. Although tissue morcellators, mincers, and liquidizers can be used in some circumstances, they have the disadvantage of reducing the amount of information available to the pathologist. Previous reports of tumor implantation in the locations of both sites raised important questions about the future of the laparoscopic treatment of malignancy, but large-scale trials have shown this claim to be false. Although emerging evidence from large-scale international prospective trials implicates surgical skills as an important etiological factor, it is important to consider the biological implications of minimal invasive strategies on the tumors. The use of carbon dioxide and helium as insufflants causes locoregional hypoxia and may also change pH. The resultant modulation of the behavior of spilled tumor cells is increasingly being studied. Although the risk of recurrence at port sites seem to be minimized by appropriate tissue handling, separating any tumors by bagging and washing and protecting the site. Hand-assisted laparoscopic surgery is a well-developed technique. It involves the intra-abdominal placement of hand or forearm through a mini laparotomy incision while pneumoperitoneum is maintained. In this way, the surgeon's hand can be used as an open procedure. It can be used to palpate organs or tumors, reflect organs atraumatically, retract structures, identify vessels, dissect bluntly along a tissue plane, and provide finger pressure to bleeding points while proximal control is achieved. This approach has been suggested to offer technically and economic efficiency when compared with a totally laparoscopic approach. In some instances, reducing both the number of laparoscopic ports and the number of instruments required. Some advocates of the technique claim that it is also easier to learn and perform than totally laparoscopic approaches, that there may be increased patient safety. There has been a continued improvement in dissection techniques in laparoscopic or thoracoscopic surgery beyond that of standard electrosurgery or diathermy and laser technology to improve dissection precision and hemostatic efficacy. Ultrasonic dissection, tissue fusion devices, and tissue removal continue to be adopted across specialties and practitioners. This has taken place as a consequence of continuous and incremental technical improvements in devices, increased familiarity with their use, and some improvements in cost of access. The adaptation of the technology to minimal invasive surgery grew out of the research for alternative, possibly safer methods of dissection. Some current units combine the functions of three or four separate instruments, reducing the need for instrument exchanges during a procedure. This flexibility, combined with the ability to provide a clean, smoke-free field, has the potential to improve safety and shorten operating times. Although dramatic cost savings are possible with laparoscopic cholecystectomy, when compared with open cholecystectomy, the position was less clear-cut with other procedures initially. There is another factor that may complicate the computation of the cost-benefit ratio. A significant rise in the rate of cholecystectomy followed the introduction of the laparoscopic approach because the threshold for referring patients for surgery became lower. The increase in the number of procedures performed has led to an overall increase in the cost of treating symptomatic gallstones. Three-dimensional 3D imaging systems have been available for some time but remain expensive and currently are not commonplace. Partially because many surgeons feel that 3D technology has not yet offered the ability to perform procedures with significant technical enhancement or to improve safety or outcomes across a range of operations. Stereoscopic imaging for laparoscopy and thoracoscopy is still progressing. Further improvements Future improvements in these systems carry the potential to enhance manipulative ability in critical procedures such as knot tying and dissection of closely overlapping tissues. There are, however, some drawbacks such as reduced display brightness and interference with normal vision because of the need to wear specially designed glasses for some systems. It is likely that brighter projection displays will be developed at increased cost. However, the need to wear glasses will not be easily overcome. Looking further to the future, it is evident that the continuing reductions in the cost of elaborating imaging processing techniques will result in a wide range of transformed presentations becoming available. It should ultimately be possible for a surgeon to call up any view of the operative region that is accessible to a camera and present it stereoscopically in any size or orientation, superimposed on past imaging taken in other modalities. Such augmented reality systems have been available for several years but continue to improve. It is for the medical community to decide which of these many potential imaginative techniques will contribute most to effective surgical procedures. Summary 8.2. Limitations of minimal access surgery, reliance on remote vision and operating, loss of tactile feedback, dependence on hand-eye coordination, difficulty with hemostasis, reliance on new techniques, extraction of large specimens. Robotic surgery. A robot is a mechanical device that performs automated physical tasks according to direct human supervision, a predefined program or a set of general guidelines using artificial intelligence techniques. In terms of surgery, robots have been used to assist surgeons during procedures. This has been primarily in the form of automated camera systems and telemanipulator systems, thus resulting in the creation of a human-machine interface. Even though laparoscopic surgery has progressed greatly over the last two decades, owing to its widespread use and dissemination in that time, there are, as discussed above, limitations. To those already mentioned, may be added reduced degrees of freedom of movement and ergonomically difficult positions for the surgeon. Such problems undoubtedly affect surgical precision. This has led to interest in robotic surgical systems, which currently exist in two main categories. First, teleoperated systems. A human surgeon performs an operation via a robot and its robotic instruments through a televisual computerized platform, either via on-site connections or remotely through the internet or other digital channels. Hence, the publicity of operating on a patient from another country. Such remote operations are currently rarely performed, but their existence is established. Image-guided systems. Second, image-guided systems. A surgical robot completes a pre-programmed surgical task which is guided by pre-operative imaging and real-time anatomical constraints and cues through the application of inbuilt navigation systems. In the current era, the concept of the master-slave system prevails, where the surgeon is the master, that is the operator, and the robot is the slave. The two are linked by underlying hardware and software components within an advanced computer construction. Such devices have been available for the past 30 years and have become more available during the past two decades. They still remain a relative rarity owing to a multitude of factors, including cost, applicability, and benefits for a particular operation or pathology, training requirements, and the support that is necessary beyond just that of the individual surgeon, but rather a whole institution level. Since their first clinical use in 1985 with the PUMA 560 being used for a brain biopsy, surgical robots have been considered to offer many benefits, which have arisen as a result of new technology in lenses, cameras, and computer software. Just as laparoscopic surgery benefited from advances in light technology, allowing the targeted transmission of light down tubing, robotic surgery benefited from computer integration of mechanical surgical arms that paved the way for computer integrated surgery, CIS. The advantages of robotic surgery are twofold. First, for the patient as the laparoscopic surgery, and second, for the surgeon. The advantages of the surgeon include better visualization, higher magnification with stereoscopic views, elimination of hand tremor, allowing greater precision, improved maneuvering as a result of the robotic wrist, which in some systems allow up to 7 degrees of freedom, and the fact that large external movements of the surgical hands can be scaled down and transformed to limited internal movements of the robotic hands, extending the surgical ability to perform complex technical tasks in a limited space. Also, the surgeon is able to work in an ergonomic environment with less stress and to achieve higher levels of concentration. The computer may also be able to compensate for the beating movement of the heart, making it unnecessary to stop the heart during cardiothoracic surgery. There may also be less need for assistance once surgery is underway. Many surgical specialties have embraced the progression of robotic-assisted techniques, including general surgery, cardiothoracic surgery, urology, orthopedics, ear, nose, and throat, ENT surgery, gynecology, and pediatric surgery. Specialties that use microsurgical techniques also benefit from this technology. Current robotic systems were designed to offer multi-functionality, including multi-anatomy and specialty capability in both operating theater and remote environments. In the current era, however, these devices seem most often applied in pelvic surgery, typically urology, colorectal, and gynecological, within in-house operating areas. One major operative barrier to adoption remains the prohibitive costs for many healthcare environments. As a result, the current robotic surgical market is dominated by the master slave of Da Vinci system. Although there are several other commercially available robots and a market open to a small number of new entrants, but also a history of unsuccessful financially or functionally or withdrawn or removed devices. This is partly because of the high cost of design and development of new robot technologies and surgical instruments compatible with them, which all require design, translation, and intellectual property costs. In addition to the robot master slave platform design, direct robot systems exist and include tremor suppression robots, active guidance systems, articulated mechanotronic devices, force controlled systems, haptic feedback devices. Each of these systems offer different advantages to the operating surgeon, ranging from reducing the need for assistance and providing better ergonomic operating positions to providing experienced guidance from surgeons not physically present in the operating theater. So here we'll see figure 8.2. Here we can see there are four diagrams. The first diagram, the Da Vinci 11 system is shown. This is a robotic machine used for robotic surgery. B, the surgical console of that Da Vinci system, which is used in the operating theater. And the B diagram is the console on which the surgeon sits and operates the robot. Diagram C, the robotic arms draped for a robotic coronary artery bypass grafting procedure, we can see. And in the procedure D, robotic distal coronary anastomosis, we can see the procedure being performed. Robotic surgery, the first 30 years. The largest systematic overview of all robot surgical procedures from inception and covering the field's first 30 years revealed only 99 prospective or randomized studies reporting clinical outcomes from over 28,000 peer-reviewed research articles that mentioned the term robotic surgery. The 99 studies revealed data from approximately 14,500 patients in trials undergoing robotic surgical procedures versus open and minimal invasive procedures. The overall pooled result, regardless of specialty, revealed a decrease in blood loss and blood transfusion rate with robotic surgery when compared with both open surgery and minimal invasive surgery. Specifically, when compared with open surgery, robotic procedures demonstrate that there was a reduction in length of hospital stay and overall complication rate. However, robotic procedures did suffer from significantly longer operative times, and their cost effectiveness varied depending on operative site, technique, patient, and healthcare setting. While this reveals an overall perspective from the first 30 years of robotic surgery, there remains an incumbent need to offer clearer clinical evidence regarding the most apposite operative methods and technology for each individual patient. Preoperative evaluation, preparation of the patient. Although the patient may be in hospital for a shorter period, careful preoperative management is essential to minimize morbidity. History. Patients must be fit for general anesthesia and open operations if necessary. Potential coagulation disorders, example, associated with cirrhosis, are particularly dangerous in laparoscopic surgery, and as adhesions may cause problems, previous abdominal operations or peritonitis should be documented. Summary 8.3. Preparation for laparoscopic or robotic surgery. Overall fitness, cardiac arrhythmias, emphysema, medications, allergies, previous surgeries, scars, adhesions, body habitus, obesity, skeletal deformity, normal coagulation, thromboprophylaxis, informed consent. Examination. Routine pre-operative physical examination is required as for any major operation, although in general laparoscopic or thoracoscopic surgery allows quicker recovery, it may involve longer operative time and the establishment of the pneumoperitoneum may provoke cardiac arrhythmias, severe chronic obstructive airways disease and ischemic heart disease may be contraindications to the laparoscopic approach. Particular attention should be paid to the presence of or absence of jaundice, abdominal scars, palpable masses or tenderness. Moderate obesity does not increase operative difficulty significantly, but massive obesity may make pneumoperitoneum difficult and standard instrumentation may be too short. Access may prove difficult in very thin patients, especially those with severe kyphosis. Premedication is the responsibility of the anesthetist with whom coexisting medical problems should be discussed. Prophylaxis against thromboembolism. Venous stasis induced by the reverse Trendelenburg procedure during laparoscopic surgery may be a particular risk factor for deep vein thrombosis as is a lengthy operation and obesity for many patients. Subcutaneous low molecular weight heparin and antithromboembolic stockings should be used routinely in addition to pneumatic leggings during the operation. Patients already taking warfarin for other reasons should have this stopped temporarily or converted to intravenous heparin depending on the underlying condition, as it is not safe to perform laparoscopic surgery in the presence of a significant coagulation deficit. Urinary catheters and nasogastric tubes. In the early days of laparoscopic surgery, routine bladder catheterization and nasogastric intubation were advised. Most surgeons now omit these, but it remains essential to check that the patient is fasted and has recently emptied their bladder, particularly before the blind insertion of a venous needle. However, currently most general surgeons prefer the direct cut down technique into the abdomen for the introduction of the first port for the establishment of pneumoperitoneum. Hassan technique and modified Hassan approach. More recently, direct optical entry has been used, especially in the setting of bariatric surgery. Informed consent. The basis of many complaints and much litigations in surgery, especially laparoscopic surgery, relates to the issue of informed consent. It is essential that the patient understands the nature of the procedure, the risks involved, and when appropriate, the alternatives that are available. A locally prepared explanatory booklet concerning the laparoscopic procedure to be undertaken is extremely useful. It is elective in an elective case. A full discussion of the proposed operation should take place in the outpatient department with a surgeon of appropriate seniority, preferably the operating surgeon, before the decision is made to operate. On admission, it is the responsibility of the operating surgeon and anesthetist to ensure that the patient has been fully counseled, although the actual witnessing of the consent form may have been delegated. The patient should understand what laparoscopic surgery involves and that there is a risk of conversion to open operation. If known, this risk should be quantified. For example, the increased risk with acute cholecystitis or in the presence of extensive upper abdominal adhesions. The conversion rate will also vary with the experience and practice of the surgeon. Common complications should be mentioned, such as shoulder tip pain and minor surgical emphysema, as well as rare but serious complications including surgery to the bile ducts and visceral injury from trocar insertion or the diathermy. Preparation is very similar to that for open surgery and aims to ensure that the patient is fit for the procedure, the patient is fully informed and has consented, operative difficulty is predicted when possible, appropriate theater time and facilities are available, especially important for robotic cases. Theater setup and tools. Operating theater design, construction and layout are key to its smooth running on a daily basis. Originally, the video and diathermy equipments and other key tools used in laparoscopic surgery were moved around on stacks, taking up valuable floor space and cluttering up the theater environment, which was not always ergonomic for the operating teams. New theaters are designed with movable booms that come down from the ceiling and these are easy to place and do not have head long leads or wires trailing behind them. The equipment consists of at least two high resolution liquid crystal display monitors and more recently high definition monitors for even clearer images, the laparoscopic kit for maintaining pneumoperitoneum and the audiovisual kit. The advent of DVD and other digital recording equipments has also led to these being incorporated into the rigs so that cases can be recorded with ease. This is further facilitated by cameras being inserted into the light handles of the main overhead lights so that open surgery can also be recorded without distracting the surgeons. This figure 8.3, modern laparoscopic theater setup is shown. Image quality is vital to the success of laparoscopic surgery. New camera and lens technology allows the use of smaller cameras. Many centers now use 5mm laparoscopes routinely. Automatic focusing and charge-coupled devices are used to detect different levels of brightness and adjust for the best image possible. Flat panel monitors with HD images are used to give the surgeon the best views possible, and 3D technology is now being used for visualization more routinely in some theaters, in some centers. The usability of the kit has also improved. Touch screen panels and even voice activated systems are now available on the market. As minimal invasive and robotic procedures have become routine in some institutions, the dedicated theater teams for such procedures has also evolved. Surgeons and anesthetists, as well as scrub and circulating nurses, have become familiar with working with the environment, with the equipment and each other. The efficient working of the team is crucial to high quality surgery and quick yet safe turnover. Laparoscopic tools have also changed. Disposable equipment is more readily available, which does unfortunately increase the cost of the surgery. However, easy to use, ergonomically designed and reliable surgical tools are essential for laparoscopic and robotic surgery. Simple designs for new laparoscopic ports are now being studied with the aim of reducing the incidence of port site hernias. See-through optical ports that allow the surgeon to cut down through the abdomen while observing the layers through the cameras and new light sources within the abdomen may be simple ideas that affect surgical technique in the near future. General intraoperative principles. Laparoscopic and thoracoscopic principles have specific principles that require careful clinical consideration. As such, they are not purely a less invasive equivalent of an open operation. For example, laparoscopic cholecystectomy is now the gold standard for operative treatment of symptomatic gallstone disease. The main negative aspect of the technique is the increased incidence of bile duct injury compared with open cholecystectomy. Better understanding of the mechanisms of injury coupled with proper training will avoid most of these errors. The following sections highlight the important technical steps that should be taken during any form of laparoscopic surgery to avoid complications.